Welcome to The Sixcast, a podcast where we discuss real-world strategies, tips, and stories that provide helpful insights for your digital transformation experience.
Hi, this is Kithmini and Rhea from Six Senses, and today we're going to talk about the digital footprint of having clients and how to get on new influencers for clients, as well as TikTok, and what the ways we can really grow an audience for a company or a startup or any small business that really doesn't have the budget to invest in a lot of compensation to get people on board. And so let's just jump right into it, Rhea. So yep. Rhea has done a lot of social media exploration. She's also been an influencer herself. She's been on YouTube. She's done a lot of stuff for different companies, and she's working with us right now and she's creating some really great content. And so currently we have a few clients that she's helping explore some social media with, as well as content creation. And specifically, we want to talk about Pirate Taxi as an example, because they're a water taxi service located on the harbourfront. And because they're in such a tourist destination and one of the prime locations in Toronto and downtown, we have recognized that we have wanted to partner with many different media outlets and as well influencers to be able to leverage their brand. So Rhea, maybe you can tell me right now, how do you find alignment between influencers and clients, for example? For anybody out there that's looking to help their clients and build recognition, what are some of the ways that you've done it?
Yeah, I think influencer marketing, it has grown so much in the past couple of years that now it almost seems like every company wants to work with influencers or is already working with influencers. I think the first thing you got to start with is, what's your company's budget? Do you have a budget for this? If not, how are you going to approach influencers if you don't have a budget to pay them? Some of them want to do deals just for an exchange for an experience. So for our example, we were working with Pirate Taxi, and they're offering the free rides to and from the island for the influencers that we pick for them. And in exchange, the influencers are creating content, they're making TikToks, they're making Instagram posts. So I think it's establishing what you as a company can afford and what you're offering to the influencers, and then finding the influencers in your niche that makes sense for the brand, and being realistic, because there's influencers that are micro influencers that have thousands of followers, and then there's huge influencers that have over a million that are doing huge brand deals. So I think it's being realistic and finding influencers that make sense for your brand and seeing what you can offer them. It has to be beneficial for both the brand and for the influencer.
So for example, for one of the clients that we're talking about, that's pretty easy, because I think getting out an experience and especially in a big city like this is pretty, it seems like it's something that anybody would want to get on board,
right?
Unintended, but but with like another client, for example, how would you be able, if you had no compensation package, if you're really not working with much, if you're completely just new, what's your value to them, and how would they want to be involved, and what kind of communication do you send to them? Do you email
them?
And what are the guidelines of checking for an influencer, for example, and seeing brand alignment? Like, how do you determine these things?
Again, everything is a bit different because each influencer is different in how they are and what kind of content they do. So I think you can offer, if you're a product, like if you're a skincare company and you find influencers that are starting up and they are okay to do posts in exchange for a couple of your products, and then you can do affiliate marketing where you send them a link that they make a small commission. So you're also making money when they promote the product, but they're also getting a little bit of commission for each sale. So that way it's kind of a good way to start off, and you can approach them. Sometimes you can approach on Instagram. I don't know. Most people have their business email addresses in their bios. I would say that's the most professional way to reach out and write something to them that's a bit personal, because a lot of influencers, they get spam emails. They get tons of brand deals coming to their inboxes every day with companies that don't even address them by their first name. So reaching out and having that personal connection where you've done your research on them, seeing like what they do and if they'd be interested in doing a product in exchange for content, that's like a good way to start up. If you don't have a huge budget, that's for any company.
So what about, for example, like this Saturday, you're going back downtown and you're going to be a harbourfront and you found an influencer that's working for you. So what kind of experience did you set her up with, and what is she going to do, and how how's that day going to look for her?
So I found an influencer who was likely going to the island anyways, so it kind of aligned with her everyday lifestyle, and she does like daily vlogs, so it aligns easily with her, and she wants to go on the experience of having Pirate Taxi take her to the island, so it's kind of a win-win where it just aligns really well with the brand. And her and her friends are excited. They've been talking about it, this event, for a while, so I know that their social media engagement will be pretty good, and it's just a good way to kind of dip your foot into the influencer marketing. Like for Pirate Taxi, I don't think they've done a couple of influencer deals in the past, but I think this year we're really trying to go in a bit more with it. So it's kind of nice to dip your foot in the water with somebody who would likely be using your brand or your product already, and kind of setting up that relationship. And then in years to come, like, you can still work with that person if it was a successful campaign. So it's also about building relationships with influencers for the brand. This next question got cut off from our audio, but Kith just asks, how do you measure and track influencer campaigns, and how do you know if it was successful or unsuccessful? I think you want to go through their engagement rates, and somebody can have 10,000 followers, but on each post they get like less than 100 or less than 50 likes. It has to kind of match up, and you want to go through, I personally go through like their comments on most recent videos or posts and see what their audience is saying and if they're engaging and if the influencer messages the people back, because like you want to know that the person you're working with will engage with their audience, because you want that connection, because everyone that follows that influencer, they're going to be more inclined to buy the product off that influencer if they have a good relationship with them. So I go through, read comments. You can ask them for what their engagement rates are, because each influencer has access to their own analytics. So I kind of just do a little bit of research that way and then look for somebody that I think would work well with the brand. And yeah, I think that's the way to approach it.
So what about TikTok? I know TikTok is something that your brother uses, and mm-hmm. It's become a family experience for you.
I know, we're all on TikTok now.
So how do you get clients, for example, like a brand or a corporate brand? What are the types of TikTok videos that they could do, like something that is really corporate? Let's take finance, yeah, for example. How do they get on board on a TikTok to be used as a brand tool, as a brand recognition, and to really get themselves in terms of knowledgeable in the market? Like, what are the types of things? Because when we think about TikTok, we think about it as like a very,
very Gen Z.
Gen Z. And we think about like a lot of music and a lot of
dancing
and a lot of hype men and hype women. So what is it? What can brand ambassadors do, for example? What can people working in the marketing department in companies do? What can they do to be able to use TikTok in their own internal communications or external communications to keep it fun and lively? Do you have any ideas?
Yeah, I think a lot of stuff on TikTok is really raw and real and behind the scenes. So it's like people want to see, if you have a small business and you're packaging orders and you don't think that's super exciting, like some people might really want to see that. And I think it's capturing those things that you wouldn't necessarily post on like Instagram, because Instagram is kind of idealized. People show their best life and they show all the perfectionist of like how their business runs. But TikTok is very, very raw and real. And I think people like that. So from your company, if it's more of a business that you're not super active on Instagram and you don't really know how to step into TikTok, you find the things that you're willing to share with the audience on TikTok, even if it's behind the scenes and you think it's not really important to see, like packaging an order or operational stuff. There is an audience for everything on TikTok. I think that you'll find something for your company that works, and just film it, upload it. It doesn't need to be high production quality. What people like is the consistency of posts and how raw and real it is. I think that's like the main goal for any company, is just to show that stuff that isn't as pretty that you would show on Instagram, to show that on TikTok, kind of like the background scenes.
While you're talking, I'm like thinking about how people could use it from a communication standpoint and communication strategy internally. And It could replace like town halls, for example, if you use it properly. I mean, if they're short snippets and they're short messages, of course, nothing that's like
Because it's all short content.
it's very short content and maybe and keep it concise. Maybe if you use it internally in internal communications to help with the culture, just to make it more fun and to make Anthony feel like there's a vibe and to also have music involved and just keep it live. There could be
Definitely.
opportunities there. And with, so how do you grow? For example, you have a client, let's say we have a client and they have never been on TikTok. What do we do to grow their following and how do you cultivate their content to now start launch them in that direction? What's the first step?
First step, I just say come up with a consistent posting schedule because you can't post once a week or once every month and hope that it's gonna take off. Like you might get lucky and post one video and that goes viral. That's very rare for that to happen for your first video, but I would come up with like a plan and just say, okay, what's manageable? 2 15-second videos every day, like come up with some kind of plan that's easy to execute. And it's short content. It's like 15 seconds. If you do anything longer, you can do 30-second and minute long videos. Actually, they even do 3-minute videos now, but the majority of people have such short attention spans that you want to come up with a plan where you can do like a 15 second post every day for a company, whether that's just short clips or hopping on trends, but turning them into a way that works for your brand, you know? So I think I would come up with a plan that way for any company, see what they want to post, plan out at least a 2 week window of, okay, we have 5 videos each week, and then go from there. Do more or less if that strategy isn't working, but definitely consistency is key in posting frequently.
And then what about in terms of promotional items? Like, can anyone use it? I'm not very familiar on TikTok, so these are my these are the questions that I'm asking somebody that's in the age range that definitely is on board with and uses it on a regular basis. So anything that companies can do that could be promotional highlights, product highlights, when they're talking about a new initiative that they're doing, maybe they're talking about corporate responsibility or there's a basketball charity game that they're doing. Things like that are ideas maybe that companies can use. And can you have a an actual company account or are they all just
Oh yeah, you
personal
can
ones?
have a, there's a business account and then there's a creator account. So you can sign up for either one of those. And
Nice.
depending on which one you choose, you have different analytics you can see and different features that you can use and optimize. I think I'm signed up personally as a creator, so I know that the business account might have a bit more. I think you can only use certain songs because they have certain licensing that you can only use on the business account. So there are little differences between them. I personally find for the creator accounts, you have a bit more freedom. But yeah, I think you can do promotional things on there. You can show products. People do like product reviews and unboxings and hey, this is a new product we're launching. And then people will start seeing it. Like products go viral because a couple people will mention how good it works. They'll show it in a 15-second video, and then next thing you know, it's sold out at Shoppers Drug Mart or it's sold out at Walmart. So, yeah. Or even if you have an event like how you said, like a basketball, like a fundraiser or some kind of event like that, you put where it is and it'll reach. Hopefully, if it's in the Toronto area, you can tag that it's in the Toronto area and hopefully it hits that side of TikTok. Like it could be pushed out worldwide, but you want to hope that it gets pushed out in Toronto and then people are in the comments asking where the event is. Like there's so much new exposure to that event or that product that wouldn't have been there if you didn't have TikTok. So I think there's a huge audience to reach.
Are there geotagging abilities, and can you start to refine your audience according to
Don't know if there's I don't know if you can tag locations. You can put hashtags and put where the location is. Yeah, the algorithm is also really intense. Like it'll spit your video out to the first like 30, I don't know how exactly how many people, but it'll spit it out to a small audience. If they see it and the watch time goes all the way through and they watch the whole video and they engage with it, TikTok sends it to another tier and that goes to another bigger audience and then it keeps going up and up until it reaches like if you go viral or if it stops at like 100 views. The whole algorithm is like it's that's a whole other discussion. I don't even know. I'm not an expert on the algorithm. I'm still figuring it out, but yeah, it's a beast. The whole algorithm.
I think this is a really good discussion. And what about in terms of figuring out like so we talked about influencers, we talked about social media, we talked about TikTok. What do you think the differences between videos, for example, and having posts on Instagram? Do you think Instagram still does the trick, or what are the newest trends right now? Or are there any other apps that companies and clients can use? For us, I know we're trying to produce content on behalf of clients, and we're trying to really promote them in a way where it generates more sales, interest into their products and services, and really highlights them in the most recognized way. We're trying to keep them professional at the same time. So can you achieve that in Instagram as well, in the same way that you could do it through, for example, lives, product reviews? Do you think they're comparable at all? What's your take on that? What's your opinion?
Between TikTok and Instagram, I think they're similar. They're similar in a sense, but like there's things on TikTok that you can't do on Instagram and things on Instagram you can't do on TikTok. Like on Instagram, you have the shop feature where you can link products and directly link it to your website. As far as I know, TikTok doesn't have stuff like that right now. I don't believe they could maybe be looking to bring that in, but I know that as soon as TikTok was launching, they had Instagram came out with Reels, which are very similar to TikTok, so they were kind of going back and forth competing with each other, the two apps. Because they're seeing that a lot of their audience on Instagram are going to TikTok because it was up and coming, especially during COVID. People had more time to just lounge around, so people were downloading the apps and then finding TikTok more enjoyable than Instagram.
This is a good discussion, Raya. So honestly, what's your final thoughts about, and what do you have to say for anybody that's onboarding new clients or startups, for example, that don't have a lot of capital? What's their best way to get their foot wet? What if they're nervous about videos and they don't feel confident on technology and they're not really immersed into this world? What are some of the things that can loosen them up to make them feel a little bit more comfortable? Do you think it's just in terms of, do they have to script write? Do they have to create an outline of what they need to do beforehand? Is there a plan that needs to be, or do you just go for it? Do you think just going is more real?
Yeah, I think it could be a mix of both.
Did you just go for it, or did you plan for?
Yeah, I just went in on it. I started posting 3 to 5 times a day, and then I slowly grew a following over a couple of months, and I was like, oh, this is fun. But companies could take that approach. They could just start posting stuff to see what happens and see how it goes, or they could go in with a plan, or you could do like a little mix of both. I don't think it has to be super scripted. I think people can always tell sometimes if something's too scripted. You want to kind of stay away from that.
Raya, this was really great talking to you, and I think we've provided some really good sixth senses and an intuitive approach on how to grow your following, how to use TikTok, and how to use social media.
Yeah, and if anyone's listening to this podcast and has any specific questions about anything we talked about, definitely comment, let us know. We'd love to expand on anything.
Send your email address so they can get in touch with you directly.
Yeah, sure. So my email address is raya@sixthsenses. That's R-A-Y-A-H at six, the number. How do we say that? Six, but at sixthsenses.com. But I'll spell it out and put it in the caption so you guys can see.
Yeah, it's six in Toronto. So
yes.
6IX.
Okay. Yeah, the 6IXsenses.com. That's it. Six, how we spell it in SixCast.
Thanks, Raya.
No problem. Thanks for having me.
Thanks for listening to this week's episode of the SixCast. We'd love to connect with you, so feel free to comment or reshare. You can also find us on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, and LinkedIn at SixSenses. Bye for now.